Hi, and welcome to the YouTube channel of Davie Community Worship Center. We are a community of believers committed to following Jesus Christ and spreading His love and message to those around us. On this channel, you'll find weekly sermons, Bible studies, and other resources to help you grow in your faith and connect with other believers. We hope you'll join us for one of our worship services, and we look forward to getting to know you. Thanks for stopping by, and hope the content blesses you on this channel.
Okay, greetings, everyone. I want to occupy your attention for a few minutes, and you know what my few minutes means. It means few indeed. The scripture that was being read came to me very forcefully. One verse popped out to me for the past 2 weeks. And the song that accompanied this revelation, it is one that, as I said last week, I'm afraid to ask you to sing on a Sunday morning because you will mash up my divine worship. But the song that I heard is Awake, Zion, Awake. That's not a Sunday morning song. That's a Wednesday night testimony service song, Awake, Zion, Awake. Awake and trim your... You think if I ever dare ask you guys to do that on a Sunday morning, then you know how long we would be here for. Awake and trim your lamps, for the star, what? Heaven shall fall, and the what? Moon shall turn into blood, and the? Hallelujah. That's what I've been hearing echoing in the heavens. But I keep it cool. I hear some people behind me like they really want to sing it. Eh? I know. The thought that comes to me from the sacred words, the portion that is being read, it is one verse. The text, for the benefit of those of you who are not and bored at the time, is St. Luke chapter 6. And there's a verse that comes out staring at me for the past week or two. It is verse 38. St. Luke chapter 6. And the verse 38. Maybe it's one of your well-known memory gems. I don't know. St. Luke 6:38. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you give to others, it will be used to measure back your giving. That's why some of us don't have a lot, because we don't give a lot. If the word of God is right, then I have to have a lot at all times. And I'm not guessing about that. Any of God's word is right, elder. The same measure that I use to give others. And I notice that some of you take it a pleasure until you make it a memory gem to say that Bishop give away everything he gets. That's why I get so much. This is the word of God. If you notice, those of you who don't give a lot don't have as much as me. And I'm not giving a joke. I'm dead serious. It is, the Bible says, it is those who give a lot get a lot. It is the logics of giving. This is the word of God. And so, my brothers and sisters, the thought that I want to leave with you this morning for us to meditate on is human's divine responsibility. Human's divine responsibility. I'm quite sure the theologians in my midst would say, how am I going to join human and divine together in one? But it simply means what I say. We have a divine responsibility as humans, and there's no two ways about it. And I'd like you to grasp what I have to say. It comes from the Lord God Himself, and I am giving it to you as He has given it to me. And I would love you to listen attentively. And I'd like you to grasp it as I have dished it out to you. It is human divine responsibility. I'd like you to pay some attention to these very simple yet very profound words. Mm-hmm. You see, my brothers and sisters, everyone who is blessed by God has a divine responsibility to bless others. And I could pronounce a benediction here. I didn't have to say anything more for you to understand that God has spoken. Anyone who is blessed by God under divine sacred responsibility to give back some of what you are blessed with. I wish I could preach. If I could ever dissect these words, I would do so. Believe me. Everyone who is blessed by God has a divine responsibility to bless others. Are you blessed by God? And if you are you ever blessed others? I am fearful of these simple words. And I cannot remember in my 60-odd years of preaching if I had ever developed a message on this text. I know there are those of you who make notes on my messages. I don't know if any of you can really come to me and said, yes, preacher, you had preached this some times ago. It is St. Luke 6 and the verse 38. Give, comma, and it shall be given unto you. And the punctuation that comes after that tell you is not finished. It's not a comma. Something else is coming. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together. And running over. Yes, sir. Shall men, now not God. Shall men give back unto your bosom. For with the same measure that you used to give others, it will be used to measure back your giving. The same measure. I don't know. And not many of you in my audience this morning will be able to say amen to what I have to say. Because you don't know about the measurement of the Englishman. The gallon or the bushel. Or the quart. Or the, you know what I mean? Or the pint. Or the big jill or the half pint and the noggin. You don't know those things. You don't know noggin. As a little one, the little, is this a little, or the most little one, or the littlest one? It's smaller than Big Jill. It's smaller than Big Jill. So you start from the gallon, you don't know McCoy. Give me a break. You just came the other day. Right. And right now, and the Big Jill is a little container. And if you use a gallon to give somebody anything, is a gallon will be used to give you back. Same thing. If the word of God is right any at all, you're not going to get a quart if it's Big Jill you use and give. Oh, if I had called a man, I would call upon one of these older sisters who have been with me in ministry to bring me a set of measuring cans from the gallon pan to the quart, you know? And maybe I'll have them put down here that I could demonstrate. Because some of you only have noggin. It's smaller than the Big Jill. Not much bigger than my thumb. Noggin. And I'm sure you younger fellows in church this morning would have wanted to like this sort of a university demonstration this morning. But maybe one of these evenings, I will do that. I'll ask one of these older folk to get some for me. Get a gallon pan and a quart pan and a pint and a half pint and a. But the same measure that you use to give to others, the same measure will be used to give back to you. My friend, this text deals with humans' responsiveness to their, not to God, but to their fellow human. Are you hearing me? This text deals with human responsiveness to their fellow humans. We don't reach to God yet. Because I told you some weeks ago that God doesn't want anything from us. When we give to those who are in need, is God we give to. And Jesus himself said it. Said, the kingdom of God is like none to you, know the rest. I was hungry, you give me nothing. I was naked, you never clothed me. I was, and you know what the rest. Same story. So when one, it doesn't make sense. Oh, brothers and sisters, pray for me. It does not make sense. We pile up our goods. We are going to dead and leave it. Give it, man. Give the thing away. Let somebody tell your thanks. My God Almighty, there are some people in church that nobody had ever told thanks. Not even a blind man across the street, you would not assist. This text deals with humans' responsiveness to their fellow humans. We are under divine obligation to give to others. Did you know that? Set it down, mark it down, write it down. You and I are under divine obligation to give to others. Divine in them. We have a divine obligation. And if you get, you must understand that you are under divine obligation to give. I have a scripture to give you, but you have never read it. And I know some of you read the Bible all through. You never read the one coming up. So stay tuned, please. These words of our Lord may well be wedded or married together with those of the same message of our Lord, that there's a message of Jesus preached when he walked among men. And do you know that nowhere, Elder, you're a theologian persona, nowhere in the gospel did it told where Jesus preached this message. Only the Apostle Paul mentioned that he preached it. And Paul did not tell us where he preached it. And I'll be locating something for you today. Nowhere in the scripture we are under divine obligation to give to others. And these words of our Lord may well be wedded together, are married together with those of the same message of our Lord that is recorded in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20 and verse 35. It is only mentioned in Acts of the Apostles that Jesus had preached his message. So it is the writer of Acts mentioned that Jesus preached it, but did not tell us where he preached it. Acts 20 and verse 35. It is more blessed to give than to receive. You know, you don't know where Jesus preached it. It's not in the Bible now. It didn't tell you where he was when he preached his message. And none of the apostles mention it. Only none of the disciples rather. Only the Apostle Paul mentioned that Jesus preached this, that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Where the text is? You can't find the text. It is more blessed to give than to receive. We may want to ask ourselves the question, what do I have to give? There are so many persons at the reach of my voice. Don't, you are waiting until you are rich before you start to give. You are going to die poor because you're waiting until you're rich. Not all of us made to be rich. Hello, there are somebody sitting in my audience today who know that this message belonged to you. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Somebody start to search your Bible. When you find it, shout me. We may want to ask ourselves the question, what do I have to give? I am poor. We will only discover that we have more to give than we can think of. Inasmuch as none of the disciples, none, and I said none of the disciples, such as made any mention of our Lord's message. Where and on what occasion it was said by our Lord that it is more blessed to give than to receive. None of the apostles said anything about it. The apostle writer of Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 and the verse 35 only made mention that such profound utterance was made by our Lord. But when and where is not mentioned. Under what occasion did Jesus preach this message is never mentioned. Had you ever thought of it? And indeed, it is an eternal utterance. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Did you hear me? You might not understand. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Listen to me, Julius Caesar. I'm up your street, Julius. Julius Caesar, the late Roman general, says, listen, no music was as charming in his ears as a request that is made by his friend. You remember those days? If you go to a place where people are requesting music, the musicians will tell you that the best piece of music to them is the one that is requested by the audience. Amen. It is Caesar said, the best music I'd ever played is asked to be played is the one that is requested by my audience. Caesar, saints of God, giving not only make friends, but giving keep friends. If you want to keep a friend, give them something. Am I not preaching? God, no, I'm preaching. Amen. Amen. Giving not only make friends, but it keep friends. Glory to God Almighty. It keep friends and keep them forever. And giving is very pleasing in the sight of Almighty God. Did you hear me? Giving is pleasing in the sight of Almighty God. Because he declares it is better to give than to receive. We do have a lot with which we can bless our fellow brothers and sisters with. We have a lot. Inasmuch as so many of you, the reason my voice, believe you don't have anything to give. You have, you will have. You have it, sit down on. You mean? Cabbage. We do have a lot with which we can bless our fellow men with. Every one of us have a lot to give away. Because if you don't give it away, you're going to die and leave it. It's a funny message. It's a tough one. Trust me. Such as our time. We can give our time. When I was a youngster, there were a lot of farmers in the community. They give time. What they call morning sports. You help me plant my gungu, and I help you plant back yours. You help me cut my cane, and you remember? Morning sports are day work. Day by day, you have a lot to give. You can give somebody some of your time. Hallelujah. You can do it. You can give your time. You can give your money. For you're going to leave it, innit? You're going to leave it. You don't think you're going to leave it. You can give your time. You can give your money. And you can give your knowledge. There are a lot of you sitting here. You are blessed with knowledge. Knowledge that could have made a lot of us better. I'm telling you. There are some of you sitting here. The knowledge that you have. Caesar would tremble. And you don't pass it on to anybody. And that's why the world cannot be better. You're just sitting on your knowledge. Your money, your time, your knowledge, your thoughtfulness, and your affection, and your smile. And there are some of you in the church, I don't know if you can smile and I am your pastor. You're always so ugly. Amen. I don't know if some of you can smile. I've never seen you smile. You'll never give away your smile. And people need your smile, Elder. Oh, people need your smile. Life is hard. Outside there is tough and miserable and cantankerous. If you could just smile at somebody. Somebody needs a smile. Oh, glory to God Almighty. Smile a while, man, and give your face a rest. Smile now. Look at me and smile. Give me a greeting with a smile. Don't hang on your face like donkey. Oh, I never seen a donkey smile. I see dog smile. Not a donkey can smile. In just long down so. Smile a while. You can give away smile, man. You say you don't have anything to give away. You can give away some smile. And still have a lot to leave. Yeah, sorry. Oh, I feel out preach, but I just can't. Eh? Our time, our money, our knowledge, our thoughtfulness, our affection, our smile, our sympathy. So many of us are going through problems. And nobody to give us a little sympathy. And you have it. Yes, you have sympathy you can give away. A lot of you have so much sympathy you could give away and have a lot leave. Give. And when your time comes, nobody will give you sympathy for you to give away yours. But the words are give, and it shall be given to you. For your time is coming. Every day as a 4 o'clock. Every sun that rises must set. And although your sun is as a risen, and you're living in a rising sun, but the day is going to come and the sun is going to set over the horizon, and the cloud is going to take you. You need somebody to give you some pity. Somebody needs to talk to you when your sun set. Lord God, for your sun is going to set. Oh, glory to God. Your sun is going to set. Hallelujah.
Better start smiling now.
Yeah. Your sun is going to set. You can give somebody something. And I can tell you something more. The way the good Lord made some of you, He made some of you smiling, you know. Just naturally you have a pleasant. You have a pleasantness about you. And even when you're undergoing suffering, you know, sure, because it's a master God make you. It just make you pretty. You're just pretty, so. Give away some, man. Good God. Give away some now. All these and more we can give to our neighbors. Those who are nearest and dearest to us, our kindred according to the flesh, our kindred according to the spirit, our fellow Christian, all these should receive our kind thoughtfulness, our kind ideas, and our daily blessings. Okay, pick up the phone and call somebody and tell them and bless them. The only time some of you phone ring is when you have something bad to tell you. But you know, you want me here about Brother John. Many of you have never called somebody and tell them, God bless you, I'm praying for you. Anytime the phone ring, he's here, you sir. Amen. All these and more we can give to our neighbors, those who are nearest and dearest to us, our kindred according to the flesh and kindred according to the spirit, our fellow Christian. All these should receive kind thoughtfulness and blessings from us as people of God. Give and it shall be given. Our fellow human, amen, of wants. Did you know that? Our fellow human of wants and sorrows our fellow human of sorrows, those of spiritual destitution. You know, there are some of us, though we are Christian, we are destitute because of this social life we have to live. We cannot even enjoy our salvation. Oh, God, so help me. There are some of us, especially when it come on to the end of the month, all you know is tears. There are some times ago when you taste your tears, it was always salt. You don't realize these last days when you cry, your tears no salt. You don't have no salt left in your body. And then you are dead when you don't have no salt left in the body. Somebody hear me. Anytime you taste your tears and in the salt, and then you're dead. Our fellow human wants and sorrows, those of spiritual destitution. Inasmuch as we are Christians, we can be spiritually destitute, you know. We dry out. Life dry we out. Though we are Christians, sometimes husband and wives can dry you out. And children and in-laws and neighbors and those at your workplace dry you out. And you just dry out. You don't know somebody dry out. Oh, God, so help me this morning. You're a Christian, but you're spiritually destitute. Both at home and by your neighbors and by church people. Sometimes church people can dry you out, you know. Church people dry out. You don't understand, some people in the ministry can dry out because they never hear nothing good about you. Everything them hear is something to dry you out. Nothing positive. It's all negative. There is a sense. Did you hear me, people? There's a sense, and a truly Christian sense, that speaks to us, telling us that those who are in the saddest and in the darkest moments and even in the most deplorable state have the greatest claim on our pity and our sympathy and our love. We hold them. We hold them. And pay it up. Pay it up. Pay it up. Amen. There are church members who we hold. We hold sympathy and love. Hallelujah. Pay up what you owe. Glory to God. Give somebody something. Give them some love. Give them some knowledge. Give them some respect. Give them some smile. Give and it shall be given back to you. Giving is that act which is most emphatically divine. Did I say anything to you? I said giving is that act which is most emphatically divine. Giving is the most and dearest heartbeat of God, the Heavenly Father. God. Giving is the greatest heartbeat of God, the Heavenly Father. As our Heavenly Father lives only for one thing, he lives to give. That's all God lives for, to give. Had you ever thought about it? That's all God lives for, is to watch over me and you. Make sure that Satan will kill me. He'll spend all night watching over me and you. Hallelujah! I'm giving us protection. His master got protection while you and I are still alive today. And that's what he lives for, elder, is to give us protection. Oh, glory to Almighty God. Such as our time, our money, our knowledge, our thoughtfulness, our affection, our smile, our sympathy. Do you have any of those? Huh? Do you have any time can give anybody? Do you have any money can give anybody? What about knowledge? Have you got any knowledge to pass on to me? Or any thoughtfulness? Or any affection? Or any smile. You want the Holy Spirit to give you a facelift? A plastic surgery? To shape your lip that it can smile? Somebody talk. Somebody pray for me. We want a surgery, a Holy Ghost surgery. Hallelujah. To reshape our lips. And beat out the destruction out of our face. Hallelujah. The powder you're using is not working. Although your powder, you're still ugly. Yes, sir. Because you're not smiling. If you'd smile, you would need no powder. But a smile would take care. Smile a while. Yes, sir. There's a sense, and a truly Christian sense, that speaks to us, telling us that there's a member in the church who wants our smile. Something is telling me. Giving is that act which is most emphatically divine. Giving is the most and dearest heartbeat of God, the Heavenly Father. As our Heavenly Father lives only to give. That's all he lives for, to live. We are his children. He gives his life for you and for me. Oh, don't let me ask you to sing it. Jesus is sweet Nazarene. And someday in glory, leave that alone. I don't want you to mash up my sermon. He gives his life for you and for me. He gives life and health and beauty. Is he make you? He make you. And give beauty and joy to his creatures. Amen. And he gave his only begotten son so that we may have life and have it more abundantly. Nobody hear me. Nobody hearing me. And our Lord came to give himself for our redemption. Can I tell you what Webster, not Bible now, but Webster, not Caesar now, but Webster's dictionary says that give our giving is a doing word. So it's a verb. Give is a verb. Hallelujah. It's doing. It's action. Such is a word of action. It means to bestow by formal action to those who are in need. You remember, you know what happened to the church? Can I tell you? Maybe you younger one would, anybody under 30 or so would happy to hear this. Maybe under 40. So in our days, there was a time in the church once per year called harvest. You remember harvest? In Grace, from Brandon, you remember harvest, picnic girl, when your parents take the, amen, listen to me, the best good kid, the ram, he go to harvest. He to talk about the best, you go to harvest, your mom is the man who farm of cow, you bring the best cow calf come to harvest. You don't understand, and you go round there, the best yam, some muzzle yam, so, and some afu, amen, and some pumping big so. Nobody don't hear me because harvest and the church always bless. Everybody look forward to give something out of what give that God gave them. They brought back something to God, and the tailor bring one suit. He don't know who he make it for, but that is his job. So he bring one trousers, and the sentries bring one frock. Somebody hear me? Glory to Almighty God. And they brought back something that God blessed them with. Once per year to the church and give to God. Hallelujah is right. Once per year, everybody look forward for harvest. The best here I am. Best Cain. Cain, did I reach up this time? Whatever you want. I don't reach here yet, so don't bother me. Whatever God bless you with, give back some. Whatever God blesses you with, you're under divine obligation to give back some. Oh, glory, somebody shout glory. Oh, God, help me this morning. I like how Webster put it, that give or giving is a doing thing. Such is a word of action, Webster said. It means to bestow by formal action to those in need. Giving. It means to yield to another. So even driving, and you're driving and you see somebody come, you yield. And if we just yield, to save a lot of accidents, you know, and save a lot of debt. Giving means to, amen, hallelujah, to yield, you know, means to yield to another needs by doing a good deed. And such, of course, is an heroic, very heroic, heroic thing to do. You, if you want to be a hero or an, what do you call, heroine? I never know what that one means. A man means a zero. Hallelujah. One can only become true heroes or heroines, real, I don't know, mythological or legendary figures of great strength or ability or renown. One who is admired for his or her achievements and devotion to others in giving or doing good deeds, amen, to his or her fellow human being will end up being a hero or an heroine. Nobody who is mean can become hero or heroine. Nobody who is a miser. You know miser? Oh, nobody names amen. Me and God alone in this message this morning. Amen. Miser! No child of God should be a miser. One can only become heroes in proportion as they have spent themselves in doing good deeds to their fellow human being. That's how we become heroes. That's how we become heroines. Such is really and truly an angelic or heroic thing to do, to give to others. Is angelic. You want to be an angel? Give. You want to be like God, give. That's the Bible. I'll tell you later on, I'm coming up to it. The only way we can be like God is to give. Jesus said it. In as much as you don't find the scripture yet, but when you find it, you can call me. It is more blessed to give than to receive. You can't tell me where he preached it. And none of the apostles tell you where he preached it. All he says quoted that he preached it. It is more blessed to give than to receive. In doing good to others or giving to others is the most elevating thing that one can do. When such is wisely and honestly done in the name of Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our deliverance, we are taking on the form and shape of God when we begin to give. When you don't give, you're taking on the shape of the devil. Can I tell a little bit more? Hallelujah. We're taking on the shape of Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our deliverance. Thus said the word of God in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and the verse 7. The word of God in 2 Corinthians 9 and the verse 7. That everyone, according as he or she as purposeth in his or her heart, so let him or her give. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 7. Everyone, according as how you purpose in your heart, give, man. And not grudgingly or by force. Because there's no blessing out of that. For God loveth a what? A cheerful or a happy giver. When we give, we must be happy. God loves a happy giver, a cheerful giver. Look at verse 8, amen, of 2 Corinthians 9. And God is able to make all grace abound. hallelujah, towards you, that you always having all things sufficiently, my God. Listen, you check me. Never run out of something. You don't believe me? How many run out and God not run out? You don't understand me, people. If you just pray for me and let me preach to the altar, I'm from my mind, you're here the same way. Jesus Christ, you cannot run out because your God is taking care. You can't run out. You must have stale bread in your yard. Hallelujah. Because you can't run out because always having things sufficiently. The word of God said, if you give to others, you will always have things sufficiently. And that you may abound in every good work. What abound mean? Look it up. I may never check it out. But if you give to God and give to your neighbors, you will always have things sufficiently. Lord Jesus, help me. Look at verse 9 of that text. You don't. Yeah, look at it. As it is written in verse 9. Oh, yes. As it is written in Psalm 112 and verse 9. Psalm 112 and verse 9. He that disbursed or giveth to the poor, his righteousness shall endure forever. Well, I may really want to be righteous forever, though. Hallelujah! You don't see it in your Bible. Yeah, man. It is there. Eh? Psalm 112 and verse 9. You see it? He that disbursed or giveth to the poor, his righteousness shall endure forever. And his horn shall be full always. That means his container. In those days it was ram's horn. They kept them oil and them fat in. But now it's not oil you have. It's not horn you use now. You have pan and bottle and plastic container. Can't run dry. Hallelujah. Cannot run dry. You don't hear me? You don't read it for yourself. Eh? He that disbursed or giveth to the poor, his or her righteousness shall endure forever. And your horn shall be full always. Look at verse 10. Then the wicked shall see your blessings. Papa, the wicked, the old wicked shall see, amen, your blessings and be grieved. Didn't I say they grieve? And be grieved and shall grin at you with their teeth and melt away. But the desire of the wicked shall perish. No matter how they want, grin at you. You are going to succeed. Doesn't matter what they do. They can drink out of every dead man's skull. Them still can't hurt you. For you're covered. Your righteousness shall remain forever. This is the word of God. Woo! This is the word of God. Your righteousness. Glory, somebody. Raise your hand and glory up God. Glory up God. Glory. Yes, sir. Your righteousness shall remain forever. And I know the wicked don't like you. And they grin their teeth at you and shoot at the mouth at you. Nothing they should do shall hurt you. For you're covered by power divine. Glory to God Almighty. Oh, the psalmist said in his 37th stanza. The psalmist also said in his 37th stanza and the verse 12 that the wicked plotted against the just and grin their teeth at him. Look at verse 13. But the Lord shall laugh at him, for the Lord seeth that his days and of destruction is coming. People of God, if you give. He didn't say when you pray or when you preach. It doesn't, it's when me give. It doesn't matter me want to preach. I mean, I'm giving nothing. I'm not coming out to nothing. Gotta preach like Paul and sing like Angel. You're too mean. You're not coming out to nothing. It's when you give. You may very well stop preaching and go give. Give. Dear saints of God, I repeat that one can only be true heroes or heroines in proportion as you give yourselves to the, give yourselves or your goods to others. It is in giving that one becomes a hero. Did you hear me? Listen, take this before you go. The result of your giving to others, the recompense is God's divine approval. The recompense of your giving to others is God's prerogative. When anybody tell you thanks, do you know what it is when a poor person go to bed and have something to eat and say, thank you, God? Do you know what it is? Do you know what it is when a person in need give God thanks for you? Had you ever thought about it? Had you ever thought about you giving somebody who is hungry something, give them one penny, and they go buy something to eat, and then, I don't know, a lot of you said some of the beggars are generals, but I don't know if them are generals, they're generals to themselves. Me give them still. Then generalship, let me give them, and him, me give him a $20, me give the man, because him not getting more than $1. So when me give him 20, when me drive up, see me. You cannot believe. Let Miss Beeson tell you, we went to the supermarket, and the fellow who push out the trolley, you know, the guys who help you pack trolley, me give the guy $20. He looked at me, he said, Jesus, thank you, sir. Yeah. Never get it from a barn. A $2 them get, a $1 them get, you know, sir. You know what you do? You help him to pay his rent. You help him put food on his table. Give, and it shall be given back to you. You know, run down and ram down. You do not ram down. I'm shaking together. You don't understand what I'm talking about. Give me 5 minutes more, and I'll tell you. Shaking together shall you get back from God Almighty. Look at it. The wicked shall see you prospering and laugh and do all their tricks. But you can't stop prospering because your prosperity comes from above. You don't understand? Oh, somebody just use your elbow and touch somebody now. Your prosperity comes from above. His master, God blessing you. You don't understand me. Sometime when you go back to your country, glory to God Almighty, I hear you, Master. Go back to your country and you go to your yard and you see your neighbors and look and say, oh, that is Susan. Let me not think she did dead. Hallelujah. Do not expect you to come out to nothing, that you can take plane and go back to Jamaica and go visit your people them. And them a peep under the train as if a Susan. Yes, a Susan. But I know Susan alone, a Susan and Jesus. Glory to Almighty God. Hallelujah. Because the plan that they have for you is that you shouldn't come out to nothing. Amen. Oh, God, help me this morning. You shouldn't come out to one thing, but by the grace of Almighty God, you're covered by the grace of God, and you're protected by God's grace. Oh, glory to God. The result of your giving to others is God's business. You don't understand me. And so the unconscious and the uncalculated, the unconscious and the uncalculated. But me cup run over. And amen! And it run in me salsa. And me can't trade with. Me have a drink what run over in the salsa. Because the blessings of Almighty God. Hallelujah! Me get good home training, but me bless. the cup overflowing. Glory to God Almighty. Now throw it away because it's the blessings of Almighty God. Oh, glory to God. So I'm going to turn the saucer and drink out of it because it's the blessings of God. Oh, somebody raise your hand and worship God. I'd like to tell, before I go, I'd like to tell all of you at the reach of my voice, God Almighty smile on you. And he blesses you. And I said, there are a lot of your people who weren't expecting you to be around. He said, who that I miss? I miss such a girl, but you look good. A long time she not see you, know, because, but you look good. Because blessings on you. Oh, God Almighty. Look at it. Look at it. If we love others and minister to their needs, then others will love us also and minister to our needs. Eh? You know, sometimes it is very fearful for you to do good in these days, you know. Husband and I were talking the other day, and there are a lot of picnic children who we sent to school, you know. Enough picnic we sent to school. You know, doctor told Husband that she wasn't going to have any children. See, I sit down there. You call them doctor who know about woman body. Gynecologist. Told her that she won't be having any children. Yep. So what we do? You know what we start to do? We start send people picnic school. Since we're not going to have none. We start to take care of our elder of those. Send them a school. You know. Sometimes it's a joke, as men and I have, when they come to the house for them money. One banker, I set up one of them school fee in my bank account. So the bank manager asked me if his child support me paying. Our people picked them, we're schooling, you know, because doctor said we're not going to have none. So we no worry. We just start school others. Glory to Almighty God. You don't understand. We start to spend on others. These days, you can't even love people these days, because if you love people these days, then say, you. If I'm a man and I love a woman, me and she along. That's why I love her. And become mentioned along. You can't do no good for people and let church people know. Then take it and mash up your character and mash up your dignity. Oh, glory to God. Let me send Matthew 5:44. I say unto you, love your enemies. You know, this is just one scripture. We can't manage, elder. We can't manage it, you know. No, me no manage it. You hear me tell you, me said this, St. Matthew 5 and verse 44, I cannot manage. You'll have to pray for me, because hear what it says. I say unto you, love your enemies. What is he telling me to do? Love my enemies, bless them who curse you. Do good to them who hate you. And pray, take your good prayer. Elder, you don't understand me, no, sir. Oh, you must pray. Pray, amen, for those who despitefully use you and persecute you. And you must pray, go down on your knees, your two knees, that Master God give you. Go down on your knees, go pray blessing upon your enemy. How can you do that and say you have any sense in your head part? But it's so, the word of God say, and since Master God says so, we have to do it. Love our enemies. Hallelujah. Love your enemies and pray for them. Let me beat this. St. Matthew 5:44 beat me up every time. So I need prayer. These are hard sayings. Look at the verse 45. Do good to them that you may be the children of your heavenly Father. Yeah. Do good to them who despitefully use you, so that you may be the children of your heavenly Father, who is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to shine upon the just and upon the unjust, upon the good and the bad. And he sendeth rain on the just as well as on the unjust. And you must be like God. Oh, it's like tough, you know. Be like God. Coming on home. Our God blesses them, even those whose hearts are unsanctified. Yeah, God blesses those whose hearts are unsanctified. And for if we only love those who love us, what reward have we? Do not even the unconverted love those who love them? Look at verse 40. Amen. Be ye therefore perfect. If you're a Christian, you must be as perfect as God. How can this thing be? People of God, hear me now. Hear your preacher for one more minute now. Look at it. Be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. How can that be? To the really generous person, the cheerful giver I'm talking. The one who is distinguished from the formal or the professional philanthropist. Because there are those who are professional givers, you know. And I'm not talking about them. They will flow to the cheerful giver. They will flow a stream of warm-hearted gratitude and affection, which will be far more than reciprocation. Amen. For all you're giving to others. The generous giver will be the happy recipient of God's eternal blessing in your life. And your children shall be blessed. God is going to set up, amen, when you're dead and gone, God going to set up some rich people to take care of your grand picnic, your great grand picnic them. You don't hear what I'm telling you, because you can't school them, but God is going to set you up, and somebody who has money going to fall in love with your grand picnic them and school them. And I'm coming on home now. Glory to God Almighty. If you mean, meanness will follow you. Can I tell you? I'm going to tell you something. It happens right here. Can I tell you? Don't take it, tell me. Sometimes ago, not this one gone. Not this one gone. Oh, you had pastor's appreciation. Not this one gone. One before this, but it wasn't a noise abroad. And that was the time when Esmond and I collected donation envelopes. I went home, and one of the greatest things to Esmond is for us to sit down and have the dinner. And me open the envelope and she look in there. I will shout and speak in tongues. You hear me? And there was one person gave us $1,000. Wait now. My cheerleader, Esmond and I saw her tremble, we couldn't believe. I believe it's a mistake. So me went to the person. I couldn't cash it, I couldn't negotiate it because it couldn't be right. And I went to the person and I said, I noticed in the envelope you gave $1,000. She said, she, because I never want to know whether she. But only a she would do that. You wouldn't get a he do that. No, but she can do them something there. She said, Bishop, you did something for my children one year, They were going back to school, and they came into your office to bid you goodbye. You prayed for them and gave each of them $200. Just two of them. And she said to me, their father and I cried. For we had never known that a pastor could be so generous. He said, same one, come back and put $1,000 now in my appreciation. Because thus said the word of God, me will get it rammed down, shaken together. Hallelujah! $200 reach $1,000, shaken together and settled. So shall they put back in my bosom. You don't understand me. Those things I don't forget. It is indelible on me. Ah, God, help me now. Listen to me. You have no understanding that God give you enough to give away. Can I tell you what you have? For with the same heart you give to others, it will be given back to you. Saints of God, hear this now. Are there not among us some prodigal boys? Are there not among us some prodigal boys? What I mean, who are selfish, all for them. Give me what belongs to me. Let me go. People, if we begin to give as we begin to get, then that will prevent a danger of growing mean and covetous. Mean people cannot give, and mean people, you're going dead mean. Your giving should be in proportion according to your getting. Have something. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Is a universal truth that is applicable not only to money but to life's entire experiences. Amen. Amen. But just why should we give at all? Just why? Give me a minute. Simply because we get. Why should we give? Because we get. Simply because giving is our duty for, amen, to whomever is the recipient of God's blessing. Such person is under divine obligation to give, sacred and divine obligation to bless others. People of God, are you hearing me? You are under divine and sacred obligation to give away some of what you get. We give to others because it is our God-given duty. We give to others because it is to God's glory. One, it is God-given duty. Two, it is God's glory. Are you hearing that? First, we are to give our own selves to God. Then we will find it also pleasing to give to others. Give yourself to others. Amen. Telling them how you appreciate them. The word of God tells us in 2 Samuel chapter 24 and the verse 24 that we should never give to God anything that does not cost us anything. Did you know that? You should not give to God anything that doesn't cost anything. You remember what the guys told? Was it David? David, amen, wanted to set up an altar to offer sacrifice to God. And the guy said, he can take it. Take it. Just take it. Don't, we will not sell you. You're building an altar to offer sacrifice to God. Sir David, take it, man. We wouldn't sell you. David said, no. No, Baba. Said, I cannot take land to build an altar of a sacrifice. I must purchase it because I will not give God something that does not cost me anything. It is not. Oh, theologian. That would not be a sacrifice. Amen. So you must give God something that. May I ask you something before we go? Amen. My singers, get yourself ready for, you know which song I'm going to sing already. You don't know. From the time the Lord talked to me, when did this hearing? You know this, people of God, listen to me. And those who are tuning in electronically, listen to me also. Had you ever given until you cry? Give somebody something. And when you find out, is the last you have? It hurts. I never give. That is called sacrificial giving. And this is what I want to close with. Your sacrificial giving. Give until it hurts. Give until it hurts. Give until it hurts. You know what? Where I got that from? I don't know my wife's father nor mother, as it were. I don't know them. Father passed on before I met, and when I was engaged to her, to marry her, Elder Brown, the late Elder Brown and Elder Whitaker, like them who owned me. Them carry me to meet her mother. So she took me to the house to meet her mother and to meet her. The two big old preacher. One over there, so one over there. Me can't, me must sit down further over, so because his minute is over here. You ever hear them crosses? Me can't go near the lady, you know, sir. That's how safe we're supposed to be. Two bishops, you know. Two of them. And Esmina way over so. And me way over so. And I ask me, go ask me. Yeah. Yes. Look, but don't touch. I see, Elder. I see. But then, when I was engaged to her, I had a dream. This man came to meet her with a bag of rice. Big bag of rice, you know, in my dream, and said, Pastor, come. I said, yes. He said, this is for your wedding. So I said, who are you? He said, you don't know me. I said, no. He said, don't is you marrying to Esmond, my daughter, in my dream, you know? He said, this is the rice and a gone back for the chicken. And I wake up my sleep. The spirit was happy. And the spirit give the sanction, Elder. Hallelujah. Trust me something. You must give until spirit sanction it. Give, man. Give. Give. I'm going to give, give, give. And it will be given back to you. 1 Corinthians 16:2 was up on the first day of the week. Put aside something Paul said to the Corinthians. You don't read that, Elder? Up on the first day of the week. Not Sunday. So you must put something out of your week's money and carry it to church. Read it for yourself. I'm not going to read it because time catches out of hand, but you can read it when you go home. It is 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 2. The apostle said, put aside something out of your salary and out of your week's pay. He saw the word of God, said, put it aside for God. He said, this is for God, not touch it. But this is for God. Don't touch it. Don't touch it at all. My friend, if there's a blessing in giving, there's penalty in not giving. If blessing is in giving, there are those who believe that they are not obligated to give to God's cause. Well, you will see. You're obligated. Nobody ever told you thanks, hey, because you're storing it up. Oh, saints, listen. If indeed there is a reward for giving, indeed there's a curse for not giving. Inasmuch, each kind deed that one does, the doer is laying treasures in heaven. Every kind deed you have done, every time you give, somebody needs something, is God you're giving it to. You're laying treasures in heaven where insects cannot destroy it. That's what the Bible said. Giving, amen, in this life is laying up treasures in heavenly places. And this heaven is not an ordinary place. It's not an astronomical locality. Nor is it simple the abode of the blessed dead. Heaven is more so where God's presence is. That's the place you're storing up. Every time you give God something, no, fasten your seatbelt, you're storing up into heaven. Therefore, to lay up treasures in heaven is simple to give to those who are in need. Done. Period. To have our possessions and keep it to ourselves is a curse on ourselves. And the destruction not only follow you, but it follow your children. So, I'll finish where I start. Give, and it shall be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. I'd like to deal with each of those, whatever you want to call it in speech. Give. Give. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Because running over, that means it must be oil or something like that. Yeah. Shaken together is corn or gungu peas or something like that. You know? Whatever you have, give. Did it run over? Shaken together. And you shall, saints of God, to the real giver, the real generous person who is different from the formal giver, they shall have a flow running from the throne of God right to them. God will bless you. The generous giver will be the recipient, amen, of the reward. The gratitude and affection of God. My friends, selfishness and meanness will always miss God's blessing. Count with me. I don't have anything to give. Yes, give sympathy. And sympathy, when you give sympathy, amen, sympathy pulls out the very best of you when you give sympathy. You get that? You don't have anything to give? Give sympathy. You don't have anything to give? Give knowledge. You know, I told Dr. Page some time ago, some of the most intelligent people I'd ever met is the man who sit down by the shop piers out by the street corner. He's an observer. You call him Professor Observer. Did I ever tell you? It's not too long ago. I mean, in my days, like in George Peart days. Hey, go on like him young, you know. George Peart days. For you to go and look a wife, you got to buy a donkey, a jack. These days, you buy a car. In the days when he was a young man, he's a donkey, you buy a jack. When in Bray, you steer anywhere. That means he's a jack. All right, strong. And the young man would have to jump on that jack and ride into the district where him see a girl in high hand. And when him see the girl like coming from school, he would hit the jack, whoop, and the whoop, whoop, and the jack kick up and he can't fall off. Lap him. And that alone let the girl love him. Martin, son, you know what I'm talking about. You see, Mike, that's what you had done, you know. You know what you're talking about. You know? Yeah, man. And as a man, she says, a man. So this fellow went, and when he saw this girl, he saw where the house she went up, house on a hill, lovely house. So the fellow went to the shop piece and saw the donkey. Where the little old man is, tie up his donkey. And he said, sir, I'm looking a wife, you know, sir. And the pretty girl live up at that house there. And I want to go up there. So the man at the shop is, I said, my pop, this book, my master, a long time on ya. I may see the girl, but I never seen a smoker come out of the kitchen there. In a make sense, you put your hand and cook. Mark the boy, just jump back on the donkey and go about in business. We are being watched 24/7. We are being watched by those we don't know watching us. We are being, if you have something going on in a church here, there's some of you so stush, you cannot even come here to help serve. I had people watching you. The man with cigar, I watch you. You hear me? Get busy. Do something. Give somebody your skill. Give somebody your knowledge. Share your love with somebody. Share your smile with somebody. Give knowledge. Give love. Give somebody something, and it will be given back to you. The widow woman gave what she had. Can I tell you, two guys who never had anything? And I promise to finish the message some other time. One name was Peter and one was John. Never had anything in it. Poor fellows them. And so, a fellow was begging. So the fellow begged Peter and John if they have anything. They said, we don't have anything, you know. Preachers don't have anything, money to give away. We don't have anything. But they looked down on the beggar and said, but whatever we have, we don't have much. We don't have silver nor gold. But remember I told you, you have respect. Give somebody your respect, no man. Give somebody your respect. Give somebody your smile. Give somebody your laugh. Give somebody a nice handshake, no man. Let somebody know you're pleasant, no man. Do something now before something do you. You hear me? Do something for something do you. Peter and John said, silver and gold. That's what you're asking for. I don't have any silver and I don't have any gold, but I have something. I have Jesus. Why not you give Jesus away? Give somebody Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Why don't you give somebody Jesus? Let us stand. Why don't you give somebody a little Jesus? I love you, Lord. Don't give me no trouble with it. Hallelujah to God. Give somebody some of your Jesus now. Yes. Yes, take your time. Take your time.
Thank you for watching our church service today on YouTube. We hope you took something away from the message and it will stay with you throughout the week. If you are not a member of our church, we would love to have you join us in person for one of our upcoming services. Please visit our website for more information on service times and locations. We also encourage you to connect with us on social media and sign up for our mailing list to stay updated on all the latest happenings at our church. Remember, you're always welcome here. May God bless you and keep you in His love. Have a great week.